Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 2127 in the name of Kate Forbes on celebrating the first anniversary of the Scottish National Investment Bank. I would invite members who wish to contribute to the debate to press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function if they're joining us online. And I call on Kate Forbes to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate marks the first anniversary of the Scottish National Investment Bank, which formally takes place on the 23rd of November. Many of us have spent the last 2 weeks immersed in COP26 and on climate change, a generational worldwide challenge. And that has only reinforced the original vision of the bank and the missions that were set for it. The bank and its ability to offer patient capital and to draw in private investment to address critical challenges like climate change and a just transition to net zero is more crucial than ever. And if we want to achieve our goals on climate change, on housing, on demographic challenges, now is the time for innovative public sector finance. And the bank's ability to also work with the private sector and our enterprise agencies is essential in supporting projects and businesses to grow across Scotland. I will.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. I certainly have constituents who have businesses operating in the net zero space who would welcome engagement with the Scottish National Investment Bank, but are presently have difficulty understanding how to access the bank. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline to us how people should go about approaching the bank? Is it through Scottish Enterprise or is there some other route?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member asks an important question and I will go on to explain how the bank sits alongside Scottish Enterprise. But the bank has obviously only been operational for just under a year. It's been building its functions as well as making investments, which is quite remarkable for a start-up. Individuals should approach the bank directly. The Chief Executive, Ailie McTaggart, I'm sure would welcome that approach. The form of financing that the bank offers will not be for every business. It may be that the grants and loans available from Scottish Enterprise, particularly for early stage businesses, is best from Scottish Enterprise rather than the bank. Can I start by reflecting on the point, too, that structural change like the change I've just outlined does benefit from cross-party support. And the bank at its inception enjoyed that cross-party support to the credit, I think, of everybody involved. And I hope that that cross-party support can continue, perhaps made easier by the fact that the bank is and will always be operationally independent of ministers. I want to start my comments by reflecting on why we set up the bank, because as Murdo Fraser has already alluded to, we already support many SMEs accessing finance. But evidence at the time, which is still applicable, suggested that for government investment to have an impact, it needed to be big. It needed to have a scale and a skill set to match the private sector with which it seeks to engage. And we deliberately committed £2 billion in initial capital for the bank, a scale of ambition significantly greater than for earlier initiatives and a statement of our intent for the bank's impact over the longer term. And having made a strong start in its first year, the bank is already delivering against its missions and actively investing in new technologies for the future, creating the environment for additional private investment and leading in the creation of new markets. That should positively affect the scale and the direction of private investment alongside Scottish Government capital and commitment to the bank. Yeah.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and she's quite right about scale. So it's with concern that I note that financial transaction money coming in the coming financial year is significantly down on previous years. And given that it's the primary source of financing, does that call into question the ability to scale? And if so, what is the Government's plan to address that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, actually, I would dispute an element of that. What we've seen is financial transactions actually being higher than was expected next year, but then falling considerably in years 2 and 3. So the question still stands in terms of how we will provide that finance. Now, we are committed to do £2 billion of funding. We have hoped to do that in financial transactions, but our commitment remains the same. And that means ensuring that whether it's capital or financial transactions, we deliver on that. That's not to say it's not hard. It's extremely hard in terms of those long-term commitments when you see FTs and capital falling. But I think all of us would reflect on the scale of the challenge ahead and the need for public finance to work very closely with private finance. The mission element of the bank's objectives is a hugely important part of this original statement of intent, because you know, the bank's missions are supporting that just transition to net zero. They're focused on improving places and allowing people to flourish through innovation. Indeed, the mission focus, and of course it's the first mission-based bank in the UK, was obviously such a good idea that the UK government is now copying it for the UK infrastructure bank. Just today, the bank has announced a £13 million investment into the Iona Wind Partnership to accelerate the delivery of the Iona onshore wind pipeline in Scotland, taking advantage of Scotland's natural capital to help achieve our net zero targets. The missions are important because through those missions, the bank is here to deliver long-term outcomes, not outcomes based on electoral cycles. The bank does not just want to invest, but to do so intelligently alongside private capital in order to make and shape markets with public purpose at its core. In its first year, the bank has not only built up its capabilities from an investment team of 2 to a team of 30 and above, they've also made investments, which is a remarkable achievement, and to the credit of the Chief Executive, Ailie McTaggart. If I have time.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. And can I first of all apologise for being just a few minutes late? I had to deal with an urgent call. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in that context, I agree with what she's saying in terms of longer term planning. Is it not the case, however, that we have to have some degree of time scale so that the measurement of the outcomes that she's just referred to are clear, and therefore people who are, you know, wanting obviously to take advantage of the facilities that the National Investment Bank will offer, that can be measured more effectively?
Cabinet Secretary, and I can give you the time back.
I think that's, I think the point is very well made, and it's highlighted in the Conservative amendment today in terms of the need to have metrics that look beyond just immediate political returns. And the bank are working on that. As I said, they are still a start-up, and they have an obligation, for example, to publish metrics that look not just at the financial commercial returns, but also at the social and environmental returns. And we need to make sure that those KPIs, they work, and the bank and with the Scottish Government are working on that. In terms of the long-term objectives, I think this is a challenge for all of us in this chamber in terms of how we measure success. Because if the bank does its job well, yes, there will be a commercial return, but there will be other returns too. And my hope would be that those returns outlive perhaps all of our, certainly outlive this parliamentary term. In terms of the investments, when the First Minister launched the bank last year, it was with a £12.5 million investment in M Squared, a laser technology company. And since then, the bank has made great strides in becoming the financial institution for Scotland that we need and expect. It's made a number of investments, whether it's a £1 million investment in R3 IoT to scale up its pioneering satellite technology, £2 million in Forev for vehicle charge points, £3 million in Indie Nature to create a manufacturing plant in the Borders, £6 million in one of the most exciting investments in SunAmp to develop thermal energy storage technology or heat batteries, a company which has now gone on to secure a major export agreement to China during COP. And £6.4 million with Nova Innovations to help expand their production of innovative tidal turbines generating zero carbon energy in remote communities. Our vision, Presiding Officer. Yeah.
Paul Sweeney, briefly.
Thanks. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. She described a really exciting portfolio of investments. One of the big problems that Scotland strategically faced is startups to early commercialisation very often ends with Scottish companies being subject to foreign takeovers. Could a potential opportunity with the bank be taking strategic investments in these companies to protect them from predatory takeovers that prevent them from becoming those big commercial players in the world that we could actually build in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
A really important point, and I know that these are areas of discussion with the bank, because if you think of their three missions, one of those missions is to place. In other words, they want to ensure that the investments that they make have a lasting legacy in particular locations, perhaps locations where there are a higher number of disadvantaged communities. So if the jobs all leave, then that is not delivering on the core mission of place. So I think the member makes a good point. And as I close, Presiding Officer, I think the point with this bank is that it has an obligation to deliver commercial returns, but it also has an obligation to the people of Scotland. This is not a government's bank. This is not a party's bank. This is the bank for the people of Scotland. And the obligations it has is to deliver on a long-term basis to change our country. So the need for the bank remains clear. It will help drive financial innovation and channel investment at scale into the areas of the economy which offer solutions to the biggest problems facing Scotland. This is only one part of our set of ambitions, but I hope all of us today can welcome what the bank has achieved as a start-up in just under a year of operation. And I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Liz Smith to speak to and move Amendment 2127.1 around 6 minutes, Ms Smith.
Thank you, and can I move the amendment in my name? I think, Cabinet Secretary, when it comes to national investment banks, just as the case is the case for many other financial institutions, their purpose has to be abundantly clear, not least because they are obviously underpinned by the public purse for which government is rightly held accountable. But they must also be able to demonstrate that in terms of the key economic indicators, whether that's in productivity, investment, job creation, innovation, growth, whatever it might be, that they will be able to deliver better outcomes for the nation as a whole, as the Cabinet Secretary said. So can I just begin my contribution by looking at each of these in turn? Firstly, with regard to the need for the Scottish National Investment Bank, about which this Parliament last year was agreed in principle, we're still very much on the Conservative benches agreed that a little bit more has to be done to clarify the central purpose of the SNIB, because despite the missions that are referred to in the Scottish Government motion, the central purpose has never really been completely clear. And I think the Cabinet Secretary would be the first to admit that even within SNP ranks, there was some dubiety back in 2014, 2015, then again in 2016, about what that purpose should be, because John Swinney was obviously talking about whether we should build on what had been the existing investment bank, and he said there wasn't going to be a new one. And we also know, obviously, that I think it was in response to my colleague Dean Lockhart at the time last year, there were concerns about how the investment bank, the new bank, would actually articulate with the other growth agencies, which I think is an absolutely key point, and where the additional money would come from. And in that regard, I have some sympathy with one part of the Labour amendment, if not in its entirety, because I think Daniel Johnson is raising an important issue about some of these principles as well. And of course, we know too that in 2014, Nicola Sturgeon spoke about the main role for the new investment bank was being, and I quote, to provide patient capital investment. But by 2019, that had slightly moved on a little bit to the principal aim of financing net zero technology investment. That's laudable, but the goalposts had slightly shifted, and I think in terms of the coherency, there's maybe just a bit of an issue to be debated from that. And I think, you know, I'm not speaking on behalf of myself in this, I'm speaking on behalf of quite a lot of people in business who feel that there is that lack of coherency.
Mention, of course, on that.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just, I'd be genuinely curious as to Liz Smith's views, because being operationally independent, obviously the temptation for government is to want to micromanage investments and therefore to be overly prescriptive about what they should invest in. And quite clearly, businesses then come to me saying, we asked the bank for money and we didn't get it. But on the other hand, we wanted to create the missions to be quite broad. And I think there is a balancing act there in terms of breadth versus prescription. And I wondered where she fell on that balance.
Liz Smith.
Yeah, there is undoubtedly a balance to be struck. But I think the key thing that business is asking is to have a little bit of clarity around what is expected of them when they make an application. And particularly when the Scottish National Investment Bank is going to deliver something. My concern about it just now is that while it's a good idea in principle, we haven't really got the sort of criteria as to what makes a successful investment and how that delivers in terms of the rest of the macro economy. And I think that's the point that many of the people in the Scottish Conservatives were making this time last year, is about how it all fits together. And again, I agree with the point that Daniel Johnson made about, you know, what's the role of Scottish enterprise in all this? How does it all fit together? So I think these are the questions I think, you know, business is wanting, and I think we have to try to do something to address that. Now, I read quite a bit about the investment strategy, and I tried to drill down on some of the answers that I've posed. And I tried also to find some minutes of board meetings. Maybe I wasn't looking in the right place, but I couldn't find them. And I think it's really a case of that clarity of purpose. And if it's patient capital, which it is, and that's important because that's about the longer term, the Cabinet Secretary is quite right to say this, it's not, you know, a Scottish Government thing, it's not a political party thing, but it does matter for the future growth of the economy big time. And therefore, as I say, I think we have to get some clarity on that. But for us, there is a really serious issue about SMEs, many of whom, particularly just now, are really struggling. They're struggling to cope with debt, they're struggling to, you know, make ends meet effectively, and these are companies who I think are really wanting to know a little bit more about what is the government, Scottish Government's role in supporting SMEs, because they are the bedrock of the economy, nobody doubts that, and how does that all fit together. So, Deputy President, can I just finish that, you know, the Cabinet Secretary knows that we are supportive of the principle of the Scottish National Investment Bank, as we set out both in the Chamber and in committee last year. But we also feel quite strongly, a year on, that, you know, it's not the right time to be judging just how successful this bank can be, because it's about the relationship with the other economic agencies, particularly when it comes to growth and entrepreneurship, innovation. And I think we've still got a lot to do just to be able to demonstrate how it's going to be so beneficial to Scotland.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Smith. I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 2127.2, around 5 minutes, please, Mr.
Thank
Johnson.
Thank you. Without doubt, we are facing the greatest moment of economic upheaval in around 80 years. And in that context, a debate around industrial strategy, the role of patient capital, the role of the state in terms of investment is clearly welcomed by Labour. But the issue that I have and we have on these benches is that 1 year on, rather than celebrating the creation of the investment bank, which indeed we do, we really need to be asking the question of what's next. We need to be asking ourselves what role it should be playing within that recovery that we have to ensure happens. We should be asking ourselves about what its role is within transition further to the COP. But instead, I think we've got a government motion that is a little bit complacent. And if I may, I think that listening to the Cabinet Secretary, there's not a word that I would disagree in terms of the need for an investment bank. But really what she was doing was rehearsing the logic for creating it rather than exploring what its strategic challenges and how they have changed in the light of COP and in the light of the pandemic, because undoubtedly they need to. But I think even in more narrow terms, and I was grateful for a response to my intervention, there are serious questions about its long-term financing, because even at £2 billion, it's questionable whether that it will really achieve the scale which she correctly, just in a moment, I'll take it, identifies as being really critical to its success. We need to see £200 million or thereabouts per year. But we also know that the financial transaction money is reducing. And I know, to quote the Cabinet Secretary, that is a headache. But there's not a word of that in the government motion about how they are going to address that. And if the Cabinet Secretary has something else to add, that I'd be very grateful for their intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just 2 points. One is, obviously, we need to distinguish the bank in terms of its objectives. It does need to deliver a return. And in delivering a return, will hopefully become self-sustainable. It also has an objective to crowd in and leverage private investment. So I don't think anybody's suggesting that £2 billion is sufficient in and of itself to meet the challenges. But the whole point of the bank is to add value by being able to leverage in private investment. We know post-COP26 that there is substantial private investment looking for a home. I want that home to be in investable propositions in Scotland.
Daniel Johnson.
So without doubt, that is important. And I think the ability to leverage in and draw in wider private investment is critically important. But that's not really my question. My key question is, How are we going to achieve that £2 billion of capitalisation itself? Indeed, we can't have patient capital if the bank is not sufficiently capitalised. But there are broader issues regarding enterprise support and policy in the round. Even despite the creation of the bank, and this is a point I've raised in Parliament before, that the government is spending approximately 40% less in real terms on enterprise support than it was 10 years ago. And nor has the focus regarding enterprise support improved. 5 years ago, indeed, the government spent a great deal of time discussing the need for streamlining and simplifying the enterprise support landscape. But since then, we've seen the creation of two new agencies and three new boards. The truth is, enterprise policy has not just seen an erosion in funding, but the bodies and the system that the government has put in place is more confusing. And so I think there is a need to address that. And again, the government has failed to use the opportunity of this debate to do that. The motion does mention a role for the Scottish National Investment Bank in terms of the net drive for net zero, and that is indeed important. But I think we need to develop on precisely how it should do that and the focus. So I welcome investments that have been made to date, such as that in Nova, name-checked by the Cabinet Secretary. But I met with renewable firms yesterday, and they were clear that much more needs to be done to encourage innovation and growth in this sector. We are simply not learning the lessons that Denmark learned 30 years ago when it seeded the creation of wind turbine industry there. Nor are we seeing any proposals, as suggested by agencies such as South East Scotland Enterprise, for the investment bank to act as an aggregator so that this crucial sector and indeed others can benefit. But furthermore, the Scottish National Investment Bank was created to provide finance when the market fails to. And the last 20 months have seen the greatest disruption to business as usual we could imagine. The impacts of COVID, which in turn has created supply chain chaos, has left businesses in turmoil. And so we need to understand the role the bank can play so that businesses can weather the current short to medium term instability to realise longer term success. But again, we hear nothing from the government in today's motion. The Scottish National Investment Bank is welcome, but let's be clear, this motion and the use of parliamentary time in this way is a missed opportunity. We face big challenges, we need to make big changes, and a state investment bank has a critical part to play. So that's why we raise the issues in our motion, why I move the amendment in my name, because the government should be using its parliamentary time to discuss these big issues, to invite big ideas. We won't always agree, but the government might find it useful if it dared to use parliamentary time in this broader and more ambitious way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. We now move to the open debate. There's a little time in hand, so if you take an intervention, you will get the time back, but that is not an invitation to extend your 4 minutes otherwise. First up, Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Jamie Huckle-Johnson. 4 minutes, Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As someone who for many years has been concerned about banking in general, and I must declare I still remain an ambassador for the Fair Business Banking APBG at Westminster, I'm grateful that for once I can make a speech positive about an important aspect of banking that's helping investment in business, focused on the future and building success. The SNIB has three bold ambitions, and some would say that these are too ambitious, that they'll be difficult to achieve. I agree with the latter, but to me the former, where boldness and audacity of ambition can only ever be strived for, is exactly the point. Already we can see that in its first year of operations, the SNIB has been pursuing its guiding missions and strategy to real effect, and it is a tribute to everyone involved. Scottish Financial News reports in its first year the bank has agreed deals worth an estimated £160 million across 8 projects. 5 of these projects are focused on contributing towards net zero developments, 2 in harnessing innovation, and 1 on building communities. I feel it would have been understandable if the first year of operations was solely focused on building institutional capacity and engagement, so such early investments supporting critical areas are to be greatly welcomed. We all know that the model required for patient capital is different, as is attitude to risk. And perhaps during the course of this debate, we'll be able to focus on that more when we look at the work of Scottish Enterprise as compared to that of the SNIB. And of course, where patient capital is investing for the future, it's likely to be some years yet before we can properly measure the effect of the bank's investment strategy. Final point, I'm sure I'm not alone in being heartened by an open declaration of ethics and good governance that encourage institutional behaviours that rest very easily with our financial tradition in Scotland. And during the course of this debate, I think it's important to emphasise the ethics around SNIB. However, such progress brings its own challenges. In the light of COP26 and considering the needs of the Scottish economy, there's so much we need to do, particularly in relation to our net zero ambitions and supporting innovation. And I'd like to put on note the comments of Willie Watt, the bank's chairman, when he spoke in Glasgow at COP26. I think we'll all have heard this, but for the record, the Scottish Government has given a promise of £2 billion over the first 10 years of the bank's life. It is insufficient to crack the missions. We need to be able to raise third-party capital, and we want to earn the right to borrow on our own balance sheet. Now, I have to say I agree with that statement. And given the lack of borrowing powers, real borrowing powers, available to the Scottish Government, it is in some respects remarkable that they've had the foresight to make such medium-term funding commitments. But had we a much more effective and appropriate fiscal framework in operation, or indeed, if we were independent, we'd be able to borrow to invest and do so much more. So I hope briefly the Minister, in her closing remarks, may be able to reflect on the following questions. Does the government agree with Willie Watt that to achieve the bank's mission, we need to be able to develop the bank's ability to raise third-party capital, or she may want to reflect further on her comments about leverage? Does the government agree that in renegotiating the fiscal framework, it's in Scotland's interest to ensure the government has significantly enhanced borrowing powers to enable further government investment in the SNIB? I really applaud the early work of the SNIB. Look forward to this stage, it being merely an hors d'oeuvre for a more substantial course in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I now call on Jamie Halker-Johnson, who joins us remotely. He'll be followed by Paul McLennan. 4 minutes, Mr Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I apologise to you and to colleagues that, due to unforeseen circumstances, I'm not able to be chamber with you today or to take interventions. As we know, the creation of the Scottish National Investment Bank under various guises was a long time coming. But words have become action is a positive, and the creation of this bank earned qualified support across this chamber, and I believe this chamber is still largely behind it. In the last session, I was a member of the Economy Committee that led on the SNIB bill. The creation of a bank also played a part in a number of other areas of the committee's work programme. There is a lot to be said about the approach taken to the SNIB, but I will have to limit myself today to just a few key areas. One is the continuing issue cautioned against by the committee of a cluttered landscape for enterprise support in Scotland. There were concerns that a new institution could add to an already confusing array of bodies, funds and agencies. And this was an important enough concern to see John Swinney drop proposals for a development bank in 2016, calling instead for enhancing the remit of existing bodies. Perhaps inevitably the last 2 years I've seen this situation balloon even further as COVID support and post-pandemic support have played an important role in keeping businesses operating. If the SNIB is to be its own institution, then it must be one that is collaborative, that works in tandem with other organisations in the enterprise space. Another key issue is the regional element. We must not forget that in Scotland it's more than just one economy. Yes, we're part of a highly integrated UK single market with a flow of goods and services. But on a local level, we see differences within Scotland, how the Highlands and Islands in the south of Scotland are quite different from the central belt, or even at a more granular level, how small island economies like mine work. One consequence of the bank's creation has been to leapfrog the regional focus of the existing enterprise agencies. In my own region, we can look to the work of the Highlands and Islands, Enterprise, which carried on the tradition of the Highlands and Islands Development Board, a body with a very specific focus on what would now be called a holistic regional growth, or even levelling up. The SNIB is a new body working in these areas, and one without the links built up over decades. But a national investment bank can, with work, be a local bank too. The committee pointed to the model of the Welsh Development Bank with offices across Wales, and better integrated with local economic development agencies. But it became clear this was not the direction in which the Scottish Government were travelling. If, as was posited at the time, SNIB's solution was to work closely with the enterprise agencies like HAI to build on their local knowledge and promote similar social objectives, and is just far from apparent in their current investment portfolio. My third area I'd like to touch on today is one of purpose. There were warnings that this diversification of the bank's objectives would stifle it from having a clear mission. I appreciate the stresses that such an institution will have, promoting economic growth through patient capital and promoting innovation, investing sustainability, sustainably supporting work towards net zero and investing in communities. The main concern voiced during the passage of the SNIB bill was that the bank would risk trying to do too much. But it now appears that its risk is one of inertia, at least in relation to its core objectives. But if we're to make a real assessment of progress, the information emerging from SNIB must be expanded, more detailed. Deputy Presiding Officer, the challenge behind publicly sponsored investment in business is to find clear purpose. To go back to first principles, simply replicating the role of private finance in investment fails to add value. But as we've seen with SNIB, this purpose has to be clear, well understood, and provide more than just an abstract vision. The worry must be that this purpose seems, if anything, less clear than it was in the early stages of the bank's inception. Combine that with a lack of clear performance indicators, and we have a report card that we cannot, in all sincerity, mark properly. The SNIB is now part of our economic framework, but while it may, there is a reasonable cause for impatience in seeing evidence that it is playing an important role in that landscape. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harcourt-Johnson. I now call Paul McLennan, who will be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr. McLennan, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish National Investment Bank is a vital ingredient in our recovery from COVID and in our future prosperity. In other countries across the world, we've seen governments use their extensive borrowing powers to invest in projects which are strategically important. Here in Scotland, of course, we have very limited borrowing powers. The SNIB was set up with three missions by the Scottish Government: to support transition to net zero, to build communities and to promote equalities, alongside being able to harness innovation in a way that enables our people to flourish. As been mentioned before, SNIB was to be provided with £2 billion funding over the next 10 years. Only recently, in committee evidence, we have seen estimates by the Scottish Government's statutory advisor, the Climate Change Committee, estimate that Scotland will need to invest £5 billion a year over the next 10 to 20 years to meet its strict net zero target. Willie Watt, SNIB chairman, stated, "We need to be able to seed fund and leverage much of that funding opportunity." He then goes on to say the alignment of making good investment that makes sense for climate change and to making commercial returns is an important combination. It's a combination that we want to foster and encourage. Now, SNIB has made an encouraging start with a profit of around about £828,000 in the period since it was opened 12 months ago. Accounts for the period revealed growth profit of around about £3.8 million, with total equity for investments worth around about £31 million. In total, it made 8 investments worth £160 million across the period, and this includes the £6 million for Sunamp in my constituency that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned earlier on for an innovative heat batteries. I'll be visiting Sunamp in the next few weeks. The team is also looking to expand to 45 from 30. On the ability to grow SNIB, Willie Watt commented, "We're humbled by the commitment, but it's insufficient to crack the missions we've been given. So we need to raise third-party capital." And we've also mentioned and heard from the Cabinet Secretary, they're also seeking FCA authority to borrow on its own balance sheet and raise capital from the private markets, which is incredibly important. When SNIB was endorsed following Ben Higgins' report, the First Minister described the plans as truly transformational and on a different scale from earlier government initiatives. She also said, "This is a clear message that Scotland is a country ambitious in its growth aspirations, a country that is adaptable to change, and a country that supports businesses across all stages of the business growth life cycle. The bank will be crucial as we compete in a global market to attract inward investors." Scotland remains top choice outside London for investors, and this is vital post-COP26 that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned before. The EY's 2021 attractiveness survey showed that Scotland remains a prime location for international companies considering foreign investment. And again, really important when we're talking about investment required post-COP26. Scotland's FDI is outpacing Europe and the rest of the UK. It's reinforced its position as the most attractive location for inward investment in the UK outside of London, a position that it's held since 2014, with a 5%, 9% increase in FDI projects. Growth in FDI in Scotland outpaced the UK and Europe, with Scotland's share of UK inward investment growing from 9.1% to 11%. The EY report also examines the performance of Scotland and the perception of the UK and Scotland as destinations for FDI. This report included a survey of 2,000 international investors. This report included an increase in investors who ranked Scotland as the most attractive part of the UK to establish operations. Deputy Presiding Officer, in conclusion, imagine an independent Scotland with borrowing powers like any other country, supporting investment from all over the world. Scotland almost invented the modern world, televisions, telephones, penicillin, amongst others. Voltaire said, "We look to Scotland for all ideas of civilization." We can be that world leader, but we need the powers of independence to allow us to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call on Richard Leonard, to be followed by Maggie Chapman. 4 minutes, Mr Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, my remarks this afternoon are made not because we want the Scottish National Investment Bank to fail, quite the reverse. They are made precisely because we want the investment bank to succeed. We want to avoid the socialisation of risk and the privatisation of rewards. We want this new publicly owned bank to be a pivotal part of the active, innovative, developmental state that we have always needed, but which is now needed more than ever as we deal with the pandemic, the end of furlough, Brexit, and the climate change crisis. The Scottish National Investment Bank should be at the very centre of a Scottish Government industrial strategy, at the very centre of a plan for good quality jobs that people can live on. It should be driving the just transition to a net zero carbon economy, promoting economic democracy and equality, and building community wealth. But there is precious little sign of this from the government. Their claim to have delivered, and I quote, "a wide range of investments" is wide of the mark. Almost three quarters of the money allocated by the bank so far has gone to just one project, which is run by a specialist asset management company, an intermediary vehicle, whose advisers include the chairman of Serco PLC and the global head of healthcare at the private equity group 3i. Two multinational corporations with an active interest in the privatisation of public services. Now, I am not suggesting that the bank's day-to-day operations should be run by government or by parliament, but this is a public bank. It should at all times be run in the public interest, for the people, by the people, and not in the interests of bankers and private equity asset strippers.
Cabinet Secretary.
Sure.
My question to Liz Smith about whether the member thinks that the government should be more prescriptive in terms of ensuring the bank is not operationally independent. Does the member have a vision for us, this is a genuine question, for bank being more prescriptive rather than leaving it to the independence of the bank?
Richard Leonard.
Well, I'm just about to come on to that, this because this is why we see again today, this afternoon, that there should be a wider range of economic, including trade union voices, on the bank's main board, to bring wider experience, accountability and engagement. Back in January 2020, on the day Parliament voted through the legislation to create the bank, I warned the Cabinet Secretary's predecessor that the investment bank as established lacked courage and ambition. It bore the hallmarks of too much tame mediocrity and it remained woefully undercapitalised. So I was also intrigued to read just a few days ago the chair of what the government describes as this mission-based investment bank, Willie Watt's honest assessment that the Scottish Government has given us a promise of £2 billion over the first 10 years of the bank's life. It is insufficient to crack the missions. So let me make this final point to the Cabinet Secretary. Your predecessor would not listen to those of us making constructive criticism in the lead-up to the creation of this public bank. I hope that the government will listen, will hear, and will act on those making constructive criticism now, including the chair of the bank, who not Parliament, but the government itself appointed. That would not be a sign of weakness, but a sign of strength. It would demonstrate scrutiny, accountability, and democracy at work, and I hope that it is a positive, long-lasting outcome that will result from today's short parliamentary debate.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leonard. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Claire Adamson. 4 minutes, please, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We in this Parliament are great at identifying problems. Sometimes, though, we are less good at identifying solutions to those problems. The Scottish National Investment Bank offers a great opportunity and a good example of one such solution. We might ask, though, what the problem is and why the problem hasn't been solved by other approaches. The problem here is, of course, the inability of the market to appropriately analyse risk and allocate resources to address the serious risks and challenges we face. All too often, finance is made available to recognised investment opportunities rather than things we need to create a better future. Banks were investing in coal mines long, long after the risk of investing in coal should have made such investments inappropriate. Those same banks refused to invest in wind energy or other renewables early enough or at scale. The costs of these decisions are not just felt in return, or rather lack of return on investment. They will also be felt in accelerated climate change. But backing climate destruction rather than clean energy isn't the only market failure. We know that investor conservatism stifles innovation and has prevented Scotland's wonderfully creative citizens from turning their ideas into action. So the failure of the market here to allocate resources effectively isn't just a question for investors, it is a question for all of us, and we need to address that. The Scottish National Investment Bank must also do this, and I think should do this in two ways. Firstly, by being open to investment in innovation, and secondly, by linking that investment to socially useful missions. I think the bank has done a reasonably good job in its first year in the first of those approaches. It is more open to innovation, and that has underpinned the success we've seen in just less than 12 months. And the fact that the bank is mission-based is very welcome. But it is in the design of these missions where there are real opportunities. Opportunities for us to achieve the change we need, the change that will renew our society and build a new, clean economy, the change that will deliver the support systems that future generations deserve. So let us look at ways in which we can develop those missions. I think there are three things we need. We need to clearly identify the problems we have, to bring possible solutions to those problems to bear, and finally, to make those solutions work. SNIB plays a vital role in making those solutions work by financing them, but we need to develop our thinking about how problems are defined in the first place, how we can bring to bear the maximum social contribution to those solutions, and in all of this, how we can better include our citizens. Because it will be through democratic renewal alongside the systemic changes that SNIB and others allow for that we will transform our society. That means we need to root these missions in social processes. We've recently had a Scottish Climate Assembly, and we now need a clear process for the implementation of the recommendations of that assembly. We need to connect the social process of democracy, policymaking, with implementation, and then we need to develop ongoing approaches that allow for our learning and mission definition to be refined and constantly renewed. So the outcomes of the Climate Assembly need to feed into the design of missions for SNIB. We need to build participation into the design of missions based on deep understanding both of the problems and of the possible solutions. We know that the perceived wisdom of the market does and will continue to fail us. So we must build new, data-rich, well-informed understandings that can lead us to connect problems with solutions, with widely supported social action, to allow us to meet the climate challenge, to make more livable places, and to support our physical and social infrastructure. So I welcome the Scottish Government's recognition that we cannot leave our future up to the market, and I welcome the work of SNIB over the last year. But we have so much more to do, and I hope that we can find ways to properly understand the problems we face and the opportunities we have, because only by defining the missions appropriately can we invest in the right things for a better future.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. I now call on Claire Adamson, who joins us remotely, who will be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Ms. Adamson, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This debate marks a tremendous milestone, 1 year since the launch of the UK's first mission-led investment bank. And it has hit the ground running. Amidst the most testing conditions for businesses in recent history. Since the bank's launch, we have seen an investment of approximately £160 million into a portfolio of 8 projects spanning net zero innovation and place-based solutions. In preparing for this debate, I looked back on the debates on the bill that established the bank, and colleagues at that time pointed out an historical gap in Scotland. Much of what was down to an institutional obsession with short-term returns and quick wins. This is a globally pertinent problem. Economic decisions remain too closely aligned to private interest and public good. That is why the establishment of the Scottish National Investment Bank is a momentous achievement in this Parliament's history. We have just finished COP26 in Glasgow. It is clear we need long-term investment focused on sustainable development and innovation to meet the climate emergency. I note the calls for increased capitalisation in line with high ambition of the bank's aims. But we must also remember that while the bank is mission-led, it is not philanthropic. It will see returns on these investments, commercially minded, but publicly accountable. The central point is structural reform in the way we think about investment. The bank's returns will be recycled across its investment portfolio. It does not account for investment from other sources driven by the availability of patient capital. The bank, through its aims, would lever capital from elsewhere. Risk-tolerant investment, which ensures traditional fixations on short-term profitability, cannot be continued, and the importance of patient capital in a recovery cannot be overstated. So, with respect to opposition motions, I would advocate reciprocal patience and longer-term thinking. The initiative in its first year is only in its first year, and it has already made a series of exciting and worthwhile investments, and it will naturally take time for the bank to reach its full potential. We want to see the bank achieve in its missions, supporting Scotland's transition to net zero, building communities and promoting equality and harnessing innovation. The missions are aligned with social interests, and that is why investment should be in the name of public good. Opposition parties need to also consider how they would reconcile the demands for capitalisation meeting their ambitions, especially when we do not have the full gambit of economic powers. If I could finish, Presiding Officer, by just mentioning a particular point about fair work. Fair work principles will underpin and enhance the work of the bank, both as an employer and a lender. And I understand the Cabinet Secretary for Finance issued a fair work direction to the bank, and I would urge reporting on the arrangements of this direction to be made a priority. Fair work is central to the Scottish Government's economic strategy, and we will lead by example and promote fair work principle to employers across the country. Fundamentally, if we are serious about a just recovery from the pandemic, the mission-led investment founded upon fair work principles is key. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Douglas Lumsden for around 4 minutes, Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It does seem strange that today we have this debate from the Scottish Government celebrating an anniversary of an institution that by all accounts is yet unproven, and as yet we do not know will play a key part of investing in Scotland's future or will be a drain on public finances. And there are a number of things that are yet unclear with the Scottish National Investment Bank. And the first of those things is the setup and administration costs. For the timescale up to the year end 2020-21, government seems to have spent £18.5 million, but with the headcount rising rapidly to 32 and set to rise further, we need to be careful that we do not create a bloated agency, but maintain a lean, efficient investment bank that delivers for the people of Scotland. A concern I have, and many others have shared today, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that there seems to be duplication of other investment and work that other Scottish Government agencies seem to be doing. And any expensive duplication surely cannot be a good use of resources for the Scottish taxpayer. For example, the M Squared deal that was mentioned earlier involved the provision of development capital that has been provided for years through Scottish Enterprise. In addition, £40 million was given to a fund that will be used by Places for People to invest in the provision of affordable housing. However, the Scottish Government also provided £40 million loan support when it was launched in 2018. So both awards seem to involve Scottish Government funded being used to support things that the Scottish Government were already supporting. So if the bank is doing more, then I guess there will be an impact in the future for agencies like Scottish Enterprise. And, Presiding Officer, I read with interest the bank's annual report and noticed that the bank seemed to actually make a profit on the value of its investments in 2020-21. I think it was mentioned by Paul McClellan earlier. But this is all unrealised fair value gains. But with these investments having no quoted price anywhere, it will take time to see if these profits come to fruition. And that's quite key, because we have to be cautious when it comes to estimating the value of investments of this new bank and ensure that we're being prudent and realistic when it comes to reporting on profits. And this brings me on to the next point, and that's regulation. At the Net Zero Committee in September, they heard that the bank currently remains unregulated. And I welcome the assurance from the chair of the bank at that committee that this is being looked at. But perhaps there should be a higher priority for both the bank and the Scottish Government to ensure that the people of Scotland can have the confidence and assurance of the bank's operating practices. I do, however, welcome the ethical investment policy of the bank and support the policy to transition to net zero. And during the evidence session to the Net Zero Committee, the chief executive of the bank mentioned the Net Zero Technology Centre in Aberdeen and its expertise and the positive impact that will bring for the future energy development. And I hope the bank can work closely with the Net Zero Technology Centre and tap into the excellent projects that are being nurtured there, provide the capital required and help lead an increase in the renewable energy sector and protect the jobs of thousands of workers in the North East. And one thing I have learned as a council leader over the last 4 years is that government of all levels cannot do everything and fund everything themselves. We need to attract private finance. And I'm not clear how the Scottish National Investment Bank will attract the private finance. I know it's been touched on by the Cabinet Secretary, and hopefully we'll hear in our summing up the plan and the progress on bringing that private sector finance that will be required going forward. In closing, Presiding Officer, I hope we can look back at the Scottish National Investment Bank in 10 years' time, can see realised profits, can see new technologies being helped and developed here in Scotland, can see our net zero ambitions being realised by the investments that we are making. And I hope we can look back and see real jobs created by its investments. And that will be the true time to celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will now move to closing speeches. And I call on Colin Smith for Labour. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate, in many ways, has been a missed opportunity. Instead of just looking back on a year of the Scottish National Investment Bank, we should have been more forward-looking. Labour's long supported the establishment of a National Investment Bank, but as a key part of the wider but sadly missing industrial strategy, we need to tackle the structural problems in the Scottish economy, including the too often short-term approach to investment. As Richard Leonard said, the Scottish National Investment Bank should be at the very centre of a Scottish Government industrial strategy, at the very centre of a plan for good quality jobs that people can live on. It should be driving the just transition to a net zero carbon economy, promoting economic democracy and equality, and building community wealth. It's clear that the scale of the ambition from the Government, the funding available to the bank, is not at a level to deliver that transformational change. Yeah, I'll take
Cabinet Secretary.
Because I think we all want to be as ambitious as possible. £2 billion is a significant amount of money, which Willie Watt alluded to. The member will know that in a fixed budget, to invest more requires us to take it from elsewhere. That is a challenge, which is precisely why we are trying to use it to leverage private finance.
Colin Smith.
The Cabinet Secretary is absolutely aware that the Government does have borrowing powers, but the problem is that the Government have actually cut investment on our economic agencies over the last few years, and that shows a lack of priority when it comes to this Government. And the concerns over the lack of investment, of course, were echoed by the Chairman of the Bank himself last week when he said the funding is available, it's insufficient to crack the missions. And as Daniel Johnson also highlighted, there's even uncertainty over where the limited commitment from the Government funding will actually come from. We know that financial transactions are a substantial element of the budget for an investment bank, but also our enterprise agencies, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency. The UK spending review did mean that we'll have a substantial reduction to the Scottish Government's financial transaction allocation in the future. And although the Finance Secretary said again today the commitment to capitalise the investment bank remains undiminished, she's failed to say exactly where that funding will actually come from. And if it is to come from the existing capital budget, there's also been no commitment from the Cabinet Secretary that it won't simply be taken from the already stretched capital funding budget for economic development. It was also the Scottish Government's expectation the bank itself would cover its costs by 2023-24, but we know the Government funding won't be adequate enough to make the investments for the bank to become self-sufficient within the next 3 years. And it was noted again, the Cabinet Secretary said only today, that she hopes it will become self-sufficient. President Officer, with many businesses struggling to survive, never mind flourish, following the impact of the pandemic, it is more critical than ever that there is significant investment in Scotland's business sector to deliver recovery in our economy. The National Investment Bank should play a major role in this recovery by financing Scotland's economic development and providing the support needed for businesses to grow both ethically and sustainably, but it does need to have the right finance in place to deliver. That's also the case for our enterprise agencies. Despite enterprise support being more important than ever before, as Daniel Johnson rightly highlighted, the government spending is 40% less in real terms than was spent in the final year of the last Labour administration. So we have to properly fund but also repurpose Scottish Enterprise as a genuine business recovery agency, working in partnership with other agencies and Business Gateway to support our small businesses to recover and to thrive. And in what, as Daniel Johnson and Jamie Halcrow-Johnson also described, has become an increasingly cluttered landscape, we have to ensure that our agencies are better coordinated to deliver that one-stop shop approach to economic development our businesses are crying out for. And Murdo Fraser and Liz Smith both highlighted that businesses are often unsure who to actually contact for support, and also how our agencies actually coordinate and work together. With COP26 leaving Glasgow, we have heard a lot from the Scottish Government about their commitment to a green transition, claims that Scotland will be a world leader in tackling climate. But, as Daniel Johnson also highlighted, the SNP's record on green jobs is too often spin over substance. They've failed to meet their own target, delivering just 21,000 jobs out of the 130,000 that were promised by 2020. Presiding Officer, we need a Scottish National Investment Bank worthy of its name, properly funded, working in partnership with all our agencies, delivering that one-stop shop for business and focused on economic recovery. That means restructuring and growing the bank so it can provide seed funding for new ideas, offer investment for capital for good projects and support businesses to transition towards greener and more digital futures, all while creating jobs and supporting our good work practices. From what we've heard today, it's clear that the Scottish National Investment Bank is a positive initiative, but it still lacks ambition from the government to deliver. Scottish Labour have long said that the SNP's proposals for the bank do not go nearly far enough in establishing a financial institution that will drive Scotland's economic recovery and a just transition. 1 year on, and this has not changed. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Murdo Fraser to wind up for the Conservatives. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
4 minutes. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, this has been a short but useful debate, I think, in teasing out some of the issues around the Scottish National Investment Bank. And the motion before us from Kate Forbes invites us to celebrate the bank's first anniversary. I think what we've heard in the debate makes it clear it's probably too early to be celebrating the success of the bank. We will know in a few years' time whether the bank has been a success. And we will see how what level of return we've seen on the investments that have been made, and we will judge its success at that point. At the moment, we are looking at a work in progress. Liz Smith set out at the very start of this debate that the Scottish Conservatives have supported the formation of the Scottish National Investment Bank, but not without concerns about how it might function in practice. And I think it is clear that there is a need for clarity around its role. And if there's one thing that came out of this debate from all different sides, is that the exact purpose of the Scottish National Investment Bank is not well understood. We heard different visions from around the Chamber from different political perspectives, from Richard Leonard, from Maggie Chapman, from Douglas Lumsden and others, with different views as to what SNIB should actually be doing. And we also know that within the business community, and Colin Smith, I think, fairly just referenced this point, people are not clear as to what exactly SNIB is there to do and when it's able to support them. And nor are we clear what the relationship with the enterprise networks is. Colin Smith mentioned the reductions in budgets in Scottish enterprise, which have been dramatic over the past decade. And there are many people in the business community who I speak to who are not at all clear what role Scottish enterprise is now expected to fulfil compared to where it was perhaps a decade ago. And the relationship between that enterprise body and SNIB is unclear. So I think that need for clarity is very clear, both internally, but also signalled externally to those in business and those who might seek support from the bank. A number of members, Daniel Johnson among them, mentioned the issue of the availability of funds. £2 billion sounds like a chunky number, but it's over 10 years. So it's £200 million a year. And Willie Watt, the bank chairman himself, said that these sums were insufficient. So the hope is that additional sums will be levered in externally from the private sector. There's a key issue around the question of risk, because the Scottish National Investment Bank only has a purpose if it is there to address market failure, if it's there to support enterprises that cannot get finance from the private sector. And inevitably, that means there might be a higher level of risk attached. I think it's fair to say, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, that some failures of investments will be inevitable. We hope not too many, of course, if we're dealing with public funds, but some will be inevitable. Yes, I'll happily.
Michelle Thompson.
Of addressing the matter of risk, we do know that habitually there's often been a problem with the main kind of high street banks in terms of their attitude to risk. And I think we should reflect carefully on where the SNIB can indeed contribute. And perhaps I'd welcome his comments on that.
Murdo Fraser.
I think that's a fair point from Michelle Thompson. I was going to come on just to reference her comments she made earlier about the relationship between SNIB and Scottish Enterprise and how the approach to risk between those two bodies might differ. And again, I think that's an issue we'd welcome some more clarity on as to what exactly would be the investments that Scottish Enterprise might deem appropriate to support and what SNIB might deem appropriate to support and how these might differ. And finally, can I just address the issue of operational independence, which Kate Forbes raised at the start. I think we need to be very clear that we cannot have this bank directed by ministers. It will not be a success if that is the case. I've heard in this chamber over the last year and longer calls from different members about why the National Investment Bank must step in and support this particular enterprise that's failing, or that particular enterprise. That's not what this body is for. And if that's the vision people have for it, it will not be a success. And I think we need to be very clear about that. So ministers have the right to set a strategic direction for the bank, but not to seek to micromanage and direct particular investment. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, we wish the Scottish National Investment Bank well. Time will tell how successful it will be. It is early days to be celebrating its success, but we might be able to do so in time. And I think the one thing that's clear from this debate is, from all different sides, is that greater clarity about the purpose would be welcome, not least to those external to here, to the business community, so they understand exactly what this is for and how it might be able to help them. That's a point well made in the amendment in the name of Liz Smith, which I'm very pleased to support. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes to wind up for the Scottish Government. Around 6 minutes or so, Ms Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A lot of comments which I will endeavour to reply to over the course of my remarks. And I just wanted to go through members in order because a number of good points were made. Liz Smith started by talking about the important need for performance metrics that can be analysed and scrutinised by Parliament and by ministers alike. And I think that's a very important point. Obviously, in each of the Parliament's audited accounts, they do set out the balanced scorecard. And what's unique about the bank is that, yes, they have to deliver returns, and we're open and honest about that, we expect the bank to deliver returns on a commercial basis. But the bank also has a commitment to deliver on social and environmental outcomes as well. The accounts were laid in Parliament in September, and they do lay out the balanced scorecard already. I think there could be a requirement here to develop more KPIs, but I think Murdo Fraser made an important point, and as much as I'm keen to celebrate the efforts of the independent bank here, and it's, you know, not ministers claiming credit, it's recognising the work and the labour of the bank's team, as important as it is to reflect on that, the returns will be seen over the next few years. You know, we are expecting returns to be delivered over the long term, perhaps in a longer term basis than any of our careers here. And I think that's to the all part of the ambition of the bank. So performance KPIs, I think we need to be careful. Yes, we need to ensure that the bank is delivering on its objectives, but I think analysing the performance too quickly is also a problem if politicians are looking to claim credit. Daniel Johnson made a number of points. I would respectfully suggest that perhaps Labour's amendment and Labour's comments are significantly at odds with what I hear from external stakeholders and certainly what the bank hears as well. And I'm not sure Labour fully understand either the purpose or the operational independence of the bank in those comments. But Daniel Johnson is free to, of course, criticise Scottish governments for the wider context. And it's right that the bank sits within a wider policy framework. The bank is not about helping businesses to weather the storms. The bank is about making strategic investments in businesses that deliver a commercial return. Yep.
Daniel Johnson.
I would be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could just explain a little bit, because I explicitly in the amendment am addressing the wider context. So forgive me, but I'm failing to understand what bit I don't understand, because I wasn't actually commenting on the detail of the investments.
Cabinet Secretary.
Which might be precisely the point here, that the bank is adding value to the landscape. I would like to move on, because there's a number of remarks. Michelle Thompson talked about the need to be ambitious, and I think we do need to be ambitious. And having heard Willie Watt's comments, because he was sitting next to me when he made the comments that have been misquoted a number of times tonight, he specifically said that £2 billion, that he was humble about the amount of public funding that was going into the bank. £2 billion is a significant amount of money. But he also said that the ambition requires us to leverage in as much private finance as possible. And, you know, over the last 2 weeks, we have heard extensively about the amount of private finance. GFANZ has secured $130 trillion of private finance that needs to find a home in investments that can deliver not only commercial returns, but also ensure that we are meeting the global net zero requirements. I want to make sure that we secure as much of that funding in Scotland as possible, and I think the bank can help to do that. They are already working with the private sector. Jamie Halker-Johnson made quite a good point, I thought, about a decentralised approach. And just yesterday, I opened one of the 12 centres associated with the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland. One of those centres was in Fort William, part of £75 million. That decentralised approach in terms of supporting businesses to innovate and to ensure that they have access to support on a local basis. Richard Leonard made one comment that I agreed with. And that was the fact that we cannot lead to a result where risk is socialised and reward is privatised. And I think that is absolutely spot on. The bank has a duty to make sure that we aren't just making investments, that we are making investments that deliver returns that can be then reinvested, and that the bank does become operationally self-sufficient. The other elements I will leave for now in terms of Richard Leonard's other comments, but I was pleased to say that there was one comment that I agreed with. Douglas Lumsden talked about the need to be prudent, realistic about our finances, which is true. But there does have to be an element of risk associated with this. The whole point is that the bank should not be replacing private sector investment. The bank should be adding value and perhaps de-risking investment. And if an organisation, a business, can secure private sector investment, then the bank should be looking for ways it can add value elsewhere. The bank is making tracks on making progress on becoming FCA accredited. I think this debate is about reflecting the fact that in its first year as a start-up, the bank has grown in terms of its operational capacity. The bank has made £120 million worth of fantastic investments in terms of meeting the objectives and is progressing with things like FCA accreditation to be able to expand and also to crowd in and perhaps borrow on the basis of its own balance sheet. Presiding Officer, I am out of time, but I think there's a number of comments that are worthy of further discussion. I hope we can do that on a cross-party basis, because to end where Murdo Fraser ended, this is not about government stepping in to micromanage the bank. The bank is operationally independent, and I think we on these benches need to have a mature discussion about what value the bank is adding, and also a more mature discussion about risk, because risk is integral to what the bank is seeking to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes the debate on celebrating the first anniversary of the Scottish National Investment Bank. And it is now time to move on to the next item of business.